the clearly lit emergency exit signs at the front and back of the theater and to locate the exit nearest you. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anika Mitchell, and I'm a senior here at Williams. I'm majoring in women's gender and sexuality studies with concentrations in neuroscience and public health. And I'm really honored and extremely excited to be introducing Dr. Monique Morris. In my work as an Allison Davis undergraduate research fellow here at Williams, I've had the opportunity to apply the field of neurobiological development to the compelling advocacy against the prison industrial complex, specifically addressing how the criminal justice system and private corporations continue to threaten the bodily autonomy of Black women, and further, how this criminalization threatens the reproductive autonomy and the physiological and neurobiological health risks of these individuals and their developing fetuses and offspring. So as a strong advocate for intersectional approaches to dismantling the violent and oppressive prison industrial system that does imprison Black women at over 4 times the rate of white women, Dr. Morris's work about the criminalization of Black girls in schools has bolstered my understanding of the school-to-prison pipeline, as well as the many ways that structures of dominance, such as the education system, fail Black girls time and time again. These systems, through the politicalization of Black women's bodies, dispositions, experiences, and expressions, as Dr. Morris perfectly contextualizes this criminalization, it's not about what they did, but rather the culture that leaves a little room for error when they are Black and female. Monique Morris is an award-winning author and social justice scholar with nearly 3 decades of experience in the areas of education, civil rights, juvenile, and social justice. Dr. Morris is the author of Pushout, The Criminalization of Black Girls in Schools, Black Stats, African Americans by the Numbers in the 21st Century, and Too Beautiful for Words. She worked with the Kemba Smith on her book, Poster Child, The Kemba Smith Story, and has written dozens of articles, book chapters, and other publications on social justice issues. Dr. Morris has other publications on social justice issues and has lectured widely on research, policies, and practices associated with improving juvenile justice, educational, and socioeconomic conditions for Black girls, women, and their families. Dr. Morris is the founder and the president of the National Black Women's Justice Institute, an organization that works to interrupt school to confinement pathways for girls, to extend the landscape of economic opportunity for formerly incarcerated women, and to increase the capacity of organizations working to reduce sexual assault and domestic violence in African American communities. She is also an adjunct associate professor for St. Mary's College of California and has taught at the University of San Francisco and California State University, Sacramento. Dr. Morris is a 2012 Soros Justice Fellow, the former Vice President for Economic Programs, Advocacy, and Research at the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP, and the former Director of Research for the Thelton E. Henderson Center for Social Justice at the UC Berkeley Law School. She has also worked in partnership and served as a consultant for federal, state, and county agencies, national academic and research institutions, and communities throughout the nation to develop comprehensive approaches and training curricula to eliminate the racial and ethnic gender disparities in the justice system. Her work in this area has informed the development and implementation of improved culturally competent and gender responsive continua of services for youth. Dr. Morris is a core member of the OJJDP National Girls Initiative Expert Panel and a member of the California Board of State and Community Corrections Committee on Reducing Racial and Ethnic Disparity. She has also served as a member of the California Department of Educational Juvenile Court Student Transition Work Group. Dr. Morris's lifelong work, advocacy, and dedication is an inspirational and intersectional call to action, and we are incredibly pleased to have her share her work with us today. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Monique Morris.
All right. Good evening. Can you all hear me okay? All right, so good evening. Thank you for speaking back to me. I am from a call and response culture. and appreciate that kind of engagement. Thank you so much for the invitation to join you tonight and to share my work with you in this particular form. Usually I do some deep dives around working on the criminalization or trying to combat the work around the criminalization of Black girls in schools. But tonight I wanted to talk to you about the overall orientation of my work and spend a little bit more time engaging with you around this question of what social justice is and how I use it, how I work it, what it means to my practice. But first, I think you all noticed the shirt I'm wearing, right? So I want to talk to you about Prince. And I want to talk to you about Prince because here's what I want you to know about me. I am a huge Prince enthusiast. We don't use the term fan. Definitely not fangirl. But I am someone who is a proud member of the Purple Army, that's what we call it. And though he transitioned last year, his imprint on my thought, on my writing, on my engagement with others, on my activism, and on my scholarship lives on. So how many Prince fans do we have in this audience? Okay, so new power, give it to me. Anyone? Nobody? So are y'all like Purple Rain 1999 fans? All right, most of you and most people that I encounter are those who think more in terms of his commercial success and his hits around the 1999 Purple Rain era, sometimes going back as far as Controversy. But in 40 years, I think it's important to note that he produced, wrote, arranged, and performed almost as many albums, studio albums, and thousands of songs for himself and for others. And when we think of Prince, we tend to think of him as a megastar, with extraordinary access to mainstream acceptance, but it's important to note the many ways in which he was someone who operated in the periphery. His gender expression and performance challenged society to consider the possibilities. His music often interrogated the concept of freedom and mastery, ultimately deciding in my analysis that to be free, he needed to have ultimate decision-making power over himself, over his art, over his product. Earlier this year, I was privileged to participate in the first ever academic conference that celebrated the life and legacy of Prince in Manchester, England. And I presented a paper that explored Prince and the complication of mastery. In that discussion, I engaged the complication of his expressed identities, particularly in the context of the Black Freedom Movement, and focused on some of the ways in which breaking the chains was a recurring theme in his music from his very first album. One of the most blatant moments of his resistance is when he wrote "slave" on his face and openly challenged, really, the control over his musical product. At that time, he did not control the master recordings of his art, Warner Brothers did, and he received that as an assault on his being. People thought he was unwell when he wrote "Slave" on his face. They thought he was eccentric. People made fun of his name. But what they missed was the fact that not only was he calling attention to the fact that the contract under which he felt held hostage was with the person named Prince, but by casting himself as a slave in the industry that normalized the exploitation of artists, he could force a conversation about power and justice that had not been made public or not had been part of the public domain. He was searching for creative ways to reclaim himself and his work. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Prince, beyond Purple Rain and maybe Sign of the Times, he had a song called "Days of Wild," and this was officially released on the Crystal Ball album. And in this song, Prince has an exchange with an audience member. And in the middle of the song, they have this in exchange that I believe does a great job of exploring his interrogation with this issue. So I wanted to play a little bit of it for you. I'm just gonna play a few minutes of the song so you all can just vibe with me and listen carefully. Because what joy it is to bring Prince into this space.
Minneapolis!
I could go on. I know you were loving it. In this song, he invites the audience to chant with him, "Free the slave." You heard that? Free the slave. But in the distance of the recording, you could say in the margins, you hear someone yell, "Play that motherfucking bass." Sorry for those who, for whom profanity is an issue. Playing that bass was a reclamation of self, a defiant articulation of power and freedom. In this performance, Prince called upon the historical memory of Black people who understood the trauma associated with the denial and dehumanization associated with rights and privileges earned by those who assume power and privilege in unearned ways. He was fighting for ownership of himself, his creation of music, and the perpetual becoming as an artist, arguing that no one but the creator could ever truly control him or herself, even if the industry and the condition was designed to undermine this truth. From the margins emerged a reminder that if he lived his truth, he would have a revolution. Working the margins provided Prince with the opportunity to not only uplift the organic, participatory nature of our interactions and engagement with justice, it also reflected the nature of his musical advocacy. I share this with you because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what you do, if we work the margins, we engage in a self-mastery that allows for the transformation of thought, of action, and of being. This is the cornerstone of the centuries-old movement to uplift the value and longevity of Black lives. Many of our, in our contemporary spaces are concerned with the current political climate, by which, you know, even conservative measures has prioritized selfishness and fear, profit, and other destructive forces over equity, justice, and love. Decisions and policies promoted in the past year have led to anxiety, to sickness, to violence, and to death. It has led to the reemergence of proponents of hate, to an intentional conflation of movements to suggest that those who rise up against oppression are unpatriotic, and to the neglect of Americans impacted by a climate change this administration does not believe exists. There are moments when it's overwhelming, but here's what we have to remember. This struggle is an old one. As with other social movements, the equity agenda that is the Black freedom movement is woven into the fabric of our social agreements, our understandings about place and power, and our explicit and complicit cooperation with those agreements. As a result, I call what I do anti-oppression or freedom work. We've come to understand this anti-oppression work through the phrase social justice, a justice of and among institutions, policies, again, agreements and interactions that involve the public, that involve and affect society. But I understand justice as an interrogation of power, how it manifests, how it interacts with privilege, access, and worldviews to impact people, groups, and institutions. In 1968's Where Do We Go From Here, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. offered that power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice is power correcting everything that stands against love. If we look at oppression, we understand that it manifests in four primary ways: structurally through policies, individual through personal bias, culturally through the norms that we accept and participate in, and in internalized ways, which are the negative things that we believe about ourselves as a function of the other three manifestations of oppression. Often our social movements and professional efforts to engage structures of oppression operate as if people are only affected by one of these conditions at any given time, and that we can somehow prioritize one over the other, one manifestation over the other. But Audre Lorde encouraged us not to prioritize oppressions, but rather to see the relationship between all of our oppressions as being born of politics of fear. She taught us that there is no hierarchy of oppressions. The movement to dismantle these oppressions has morphed over time, but students of history, particularly movement history, understand that our struggle for justice and equity is a praxis, not an analysis or an aberration of this particular experience with democracy. I say this not to disparage the idea of a multicultural, multiracial democracy, but I do offer that our effort to engage in anti-oppression work consider the extent to which our work responds to improving the conditions of those in the margins of society, of those we cannot see or can barely hear. So instead of thinking of social justice as a field or as a profession that captures this work, I think of social justice as the action to combat oppression and harm in our society. That way, it doesn't matter what you do as a chosen profession. What matters are the actions you take wherever you are, whoever you are. Sojourner Truth in 1851 offered a framework for pushing this nation toward an articulation of freedom and power to correct everything that stands against love. She said, "And ain't I a woman? Look at me, look at my arm. I could have plowed and planted and gathered into barns, and no man could head me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it, and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most of them sold off to slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman?" In this excerpt is a complication of the normed framework about the public identity of women. She exposed a gap from the margins in the ideological foundation of the suffragist movement by calling attention to the fact that white women's experiences could not speak universally for all women. This is important because in the gaps live challenges to the assumptions that undermine our capacity to work with intention to dismantle oppressions and to advance equity agendas that are responsive to those with the greatest need. Now, in practice, equality and equity are two different things. Equality is about treating all things or people the same. But equity is about giving people what they need for equal access to opportunity. It's a particular interpretation of fairness. My philosophy is that if you strive for the latter, it'll produce the former. Kimberly Crenshaw expanded upon Sojourner Truth's and Audre Lorde's foundation in her articulation of intersectionality. In her contributions to critical race theory, Dr. Crenshaw invited us to map the margins. In other words, to explore the sections of our society, the various aspects of our identities that are unprotected because of a failure to acknowledge that they exist and inform our relationships with systems, structures, and people, et cetera. But as our scholarship has become more skilled in mapping spaces, we have privileged propositional knowing, the facts, the data, to the virtual exclusion of experiential knowing and presentational knowing, stories and art, such that we are limiting our capacity for learning more about these spaces. For example, our mapping has taught us that some populations are disproportionately vulnerable to harm. For example, my personal scholarship and the work of the National Black Women's Justice Institute engages methods to support propositional knowing when we release statistical data to help inform our understanding of this complex issue of school discipline. Without the quantitative analysis of school discipline data, we might not know just how egregious the racial disparities are among girls, and that Black girls are disproportionately overrepresented along the continuum of discipline in schools, or that the racial disparities are greater for girls than they are even for boys. But without other ways of knowing, we also wouldn't understand why this is happening and what we can do to fix it. The gap between what we know and what we do is alarmingly wide. We know about these disparities and we know that they are linked to trauma, but schools have yet to develop robust intervention strategies that engage responses to trauma in their approaches to solving conflict among students. Of course, there are some students that are exploratory and are engaged in using data to inform pedagogical practices and student performance outcomes associated with this issue. But as scholars and emerging scholars, we often map the margins and develop theories to explore various social justice concerns, and then we stop. Or we fail to effectively partner with people from the affected community who can expose the gaps and or use this information to effectuate change. It's important to remember that the frameworks produced from mapping, intersectionality included, were always intended to support action, engagement, praxis. So actions got next in this work. Working the margins toward an equity agenda involves combining scholarship with organizing, training, providing technical assistance, evaluation, and innovation where necessary. One of our greatest historical examples of someone working the margins to advance equity is Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, who as founder of the Daytona National and Industrial School for Negro Girls, now Bethune-Cookman University, as the founder of the National Council on Negro Women, and as a champion of racial and gender equity, understood that working the margins required an understanding of power and a negotiation and wrestling with that power to improve outcomes for all, especially those without privilege or influence. She worked the margins and used autoethnographic methods to understand the ways that Black girls were being prevented from receiving a quality education. And she responded by creating a school for Black girls. She recognized the absence of African American influence on policies that impacted their lives. So she served as an advisor in formal and informal ways to several presidents. In her last will and statement, where she shared several of her final wishes, Dr. Bethune offered, "I leave you respect for the uses of power." Notice she didn't say, I want you to respect power. She said, "I leave you respect for the uses of power." She wrote, "We live in a world which respects power above all things. Power, intelligently directed, can lead to more freedom. Unwisely directed, it can be a dreadful, destructive force. During my lifetime, I have seen the power of the Negro grow enormously. It has always been my first concern that this power should be placed on the side of human justice." Collective engagement is power. Dr. Bethune's justice was action. In my own work, the respect for power has meant that I, along with my colleagues and partners in this work, have to be willing to step outside of our place of comfort and privilege and understand that when we see ourselves in the communities we work with, we are altering the conditions that prevent power from being on the side of human justice. We work the margins in our effort to interrupt school-to-confinement pathways for girls of color by generating reports that continue to document the unique and disproportionate ways that Black and brown girls are experiencing exclusionary discipline and contact with points of entry to the juvenile court and criminal legal systems. But it's also about setting the intention and rolling up sleeves to shift the conditions that facilitate a criminalization of Black and brown girls. It involves increasing the rigor of our analysis to center those who are most marginalized in our conversations about justice, as NBWJI did this fall with the release of our policy report centering Black women, girls, gender non-binary people in campaigns for sanctuary and freedom. It involves linking arms with community and educational partners to launch an educational reentry program for girls impacted by school pushout. It involves developing a decision-making tool for educators and who are working to increase their capacity to stop school pushout and the over-reliance on school discipline. It involves the everyday conversations that we have to increase our capacity to use power to implement what Dr. King called the demands of justice. As power is critical to the transformation of relationships between people, institutions, and structures, when we work the margins using social justice as a praxis, we are forced to challenge what we think we know about fields of inquiry, research methods, and the population at the center of our work. From these spaces, I offer three observations or invitations about working the margins to dismantle oppression and engage social justice, not as a field of work, but as an actual praxis. So the first thing I wanna say is, tell stories. Not the kind of stories that like your grandmother might've told you not to tell, that are also known as lies or fibs, but tell the story. I've learned not to privilege propositional knowing. Facts and data are a critical part of my work, and they're important to me as my work reflects. But every book that I have written, from the street novel, Too Beautiful for Words, to working with Kemba Smith on her biography, Poster Child, for those who are not familiar with Kemba Smith, she was sentenced to 24 and a half years in federal prison for basically being the girlfriend of a drug dealer. Her work is about dismantling mandatory minimum sentences, particularly among women. Even in Black Stats, it's a I consider it a statistical narrative of the conditions impacting Black America. And in that, embedded in that work is a form of storytelling. And in Pushout, the book that is most recent and that explores the criminalization of Black girls in schools. But I also tell stories that I hope will inspire people to shift the conditions that I explore in these works. And I do that also in all of the policy papers that we see that have also been a part of this work. I believe that facts without context and texture can facilitate harm. So we need to tell the stories. They help us to shift the narrative that informed the development of a collective public consciousness, and that all that manifests in our cultures and norms. There's also healing power in the telling of story. There's healing power in the exchange of narrative. Earlier this year, in an event that I did at the Schomburg Center in New York with Monifa Bandele with Moms Rising, she offered that erasure is a form of violence. The failure for us to tell the stories that accompany the data, the research, the engagement around these topics, the learnings that we take away from our study of important issues, is a form of erasure. And so we have to consider that in our work. Speaking one's truth into the universe, releases that energy, I believe, and it provides the opportunity for learning and healing and the development of new experiences and partnerships. Understand that participatory processes are ancient and they are the future. So this is my approach to research and to engaging the affected communities in whatever action I'm taking to uplift justice. The distribution of power begins with the recognition that knowledge and expertise are also distributed. You don't have all the answers. I don't have all the answers. And that's okay, because collectively we have the answers. That's a very different orientation than building up one's own individual expertise to emerge as the expert in the field. But participatory processes are ancient and they are the future. Those which recognize and center the expertise of affected populations have historically invited a deeper conversation about issues and provided the opportunity for an increase in the capacity among the community, the affected community, to activate and or strengthen their leadership capacity on a given issue. I believe that no one can empower another individual, but I do believe that a person can give someone the tools to be empowered. You can increase their capacity to be empowered. Our ancestors knew the power of collective engagement and distributed learning, but as a society, as our society has become more competitive, we have come to prioritize the location of expertise in single individuals. I'm so pleased that forward-thinking foundations and other leaders are beginning to reconsider this approach and are thinking about strategies to engage whole communities, envisioning and planning efforts to transform conditions in their communities. The work of the Young Women's Initiative in New York City, led by the City Council, Girls for Gender Equity, the YWCA, and the New York Women's Foundation, is a powerful example of some of the transformative power of participatory engagement. Cisgender and transgender girls of color who were impacted by the city's programs and institutional structures work together in teams that are responsive to areas of education and economic development, housing, et cetera, to develop a very robust policy platform that addresses how the city can better respond to their needs and well-being. Hashtag SheWillBe is both the website and the media brand for this work, and it is being replicated in cities across the country. It's outstanding work and is a demonstration of how people are thinking more inclusively about working the margins and about engaging and practicing a form of intersectionality beyond just using it to label our work. As more and more people, including scholars, advocates, youth, justice practitioners alike, recognize the power of working together, the more common these projects are becoming, because they work. Know that critical scholarship is essential to progressive movement. So when I was in college, especially the early years, I wrote a lot of angry papers. How many of you have written angry papers? They're so satisfying. But I learned that I found a rhythm in the fiery words that I knew would speak a truth, but that they weren't satisfying all of me, right? They could satisfy the frustration that I was feeling, and I certainly found joy in the questions that might challenge the perceptions others might have about me, my racial identity, my performance of gender. But I came to realize that while my well of anger and frustration with structures of oppression had produced a sharp critique of institutions and policies that were impacting Black communities in particular, I was not made whole simply by articulating the problem. I realized that I had to be part of the solution. I realized that my perspective was not reflected in the literature that I was reading, nor was it present among the advocacy initiatives that were being introduced and implemented at the time in the field that I was interested in joining. So I began to write differently. I began to listen differently. I began to observe the conditions around me with a fresh pair of eyes that were not tainted by the search for something wrong, but rather to engage my radical imagination on what could be right. That was a continuous process, and I don't believe that you can suddenly, you know, flip the switch and become woke the way that people talk about it. The consciousness of this Black freedom movement especially is constantly in development, but we have to have this commitment to improvement across the board in advancing equity agendas. So write your angry papers. I always encourage students and faculty and others that I work with to make sure we're writing angry papers, but not to get buried in by the anger, not to get sucked in with the angry energy. Understand that freedom and justice is not a pie that can be divvied up. The capacity for justice is as infinite as space. We just have to put work into these spaces to identify where there are opportunities to dismantle oppression. So as I close my comments to you this evening, I would like to offer a few more thoughts about why I say social justice is a verb. Our contemporary movement for justice and equity is growing in the margins, but our goal is to create a popular culture of equity where human interactions, policies, and practices are led by love, not fear. Leading with love is, again, to borrow Dr. King's frame, using power to correct everything that stands against love. And it is one of the most radical acts that we can engage in at this time. But remember that this love is not about how it flows only from you to another individual. It is also about the care and love and attention you give to yourself so that you can heal, so we all can heal from the historical traumas associated with oppression and recover from current assaults, macro and micro, on our humanity and our planet. Ultimately, this radical act of leading with love is what produces a self-awareness and self-mastery that liberates us from conditions of oppression. Free the slave. Everyone needs a little more Prince in their lives. So I'm bringing him back into this space. But understanding that mastery of self is essential to liberation means working the margins, and that includes doing that internal work. This healing requires patience and practice. It's hard work and it's necessary work. It's love in its purest form and it's power at its best. Thank you.
Hello. I'm Peter Pijos. I'm a visiting assistant professor of African American history, and I am super excited to be up here with Dr. Morris. So I think the idea for how this is going to go is I can ask some questions, but we'd also love for folks in the audience to ask questions. So maybe I'll kick it off with a big question and a small question, and then we will, hopefully you guys will think of some things that you want to ask about. So I guess as a historian, one of the things that interested me about your talk was just listening to you frame some of the questions and seeing where you were connecting with historical movements. So I was wondering if you could speak a bit about kind of the Black freedom movement broadly and sort of how that frame helps kind of shape the work that you do and the way that you think about the work that you do. So how you see yourself in the longer stream.
Yeah, thank you. I think For me, so I should share that my mentor is Manning Marable. And so he had this way of framing work as contemporary Black history, and this way of challenging us to think about our place in the overall Black freedom movement as students and as emerging scholars in this work, and even as established scholars in this work, through a critical lens of both situating and locating conversations about justice in their proper historical context, but also exploring what is shared in our energy to uplift core concepts of justice and freedom that have always been present. And to examine that, not just by using some of the more traditional modes of inquiry, but also to really think about how we might engage people who are affected by these conditions in very robust ways. So that, I say, has really provided a foundation for my own approach to this work and as a participatory engagement. And in my practice, my participation is not just with those who are living, but also with those who came before me. And so as part of a participatory practice, it's an acknowledgement of the ongoing contributions to this conversation from ancestors in this work, from previous freedom movements as they have shown up in various spaces, but also to use those movements as a lens through which to examine current conditions and practices and language that might help us better understand it and combat oppressions. If that makes sense to folks. Essentially, you know, for me, there is one freedom movement. It has had iterations over time. We have lessons that we might learn from those things. Like, I refer to our current space as our neo-redeemer era. So yeah, I think, so there are ways.
It's a powerful parallel.
I mean, you know, there are ways of understanding our contemporary conditions and what we have, what we're up against by examining history and those lessons there.
Thank you. It's not surprising to me to hear that you were trained and inspired by Manning Marable. For those of you who don't know, Manning Marable was a prominent Black left intellectual. He wrote a Pulitzer Prize winning biography of Malcolm X. That's amazing, but also was really involved in public life and public debates around justice and social movements, both economic justice and racial justice. So I guess I wanted to pick up on another thing you said there, and this is really your engagement with others, and particularly your engagement with people who are situated at the margins. And you know, in this political moment, the thing I find myself asking, and I think lots of people at institutions like Williams who care about justice find ourselves asking, is how do we work with people on the margins for justice? Not for them, not about them, but with them.
Yeah. Commit. So when I talk to scholars, you know, and folks who are engaged in research work, they feel sometimes disconnected by the isolation of the academy. Or they feel that they would not be welcome in communities because of, you know, potential contentious relationships between the institution and community, or some of the relationships that have been problematic in the past between institutions and communities that are at the center of studies and inquiry around these issues. But I have found that acknowledging those relationships from the outset are particularly helpful, and partnering and approaching research as a partnership and not as you know, something where, you know, individuals can support your own inquiry is an important shift in frame. You know, I do believe that people operate from energy, and especially communities that have been that have been around for a while have a memory. And so engaging with communities means not going to them saying, I'm doing a research project, can you help me, right? But understanding that we have a question and that there's a way to engage together in building this work. Much of how I engage with this is through participatory action research, and I use those methods to build capacity not just to extract from a community, extract its expertise, its knowledge, its love, its acceptance, but also to figure out ways to build capacity in communities so that we all walk away from this exchange with something beneficial. Oftentimes, especially with students, they'll say, I'm about to get a degree, so let's me go into this community and do my study. And your benefit is you get to have my study, but I get a degree, right? That may not be seen as a mutually beneficial exchange. And so understanding how to have conversations with people that really explore what they might need to be a part of a study or an exploration, inviting them and honoring their expertise in real ways, concrete ways, is also an important way to talk about this. But really, you know, I have found greatest success in exploring research as a partnership, and that for me goes a long way.
Yeah, I love that answer, and I mean, I could really see it from reading Pushout, because one of the things, and I'm sure a bunch of you will want to read it, the book after this session. One of the things is just the girls' voices come through in some of the chapters in just such a moving way. So I was wondering if you maybe could talk a little bit more about that specific experience of researching that book and kind of, I mean, you mentioned this kind of the way in which knowledge really is decentralized and the way in which people through their experience and their sensory interaction in the world know things that we can't. So I guess I'd just like to hear more about kind of how you interacted with the girls and built their trust, but then also like what were some of the things that you having all your expertise in this topic learned from these girls who had really experienced the ways in which schools marginalized them?
Yeah, so, you know, I think, you know, and I say this in the book, that in many ways, Pushout began to be a part of my consciousness when I wrote Too Beautiful for Words, which was the street novel about prostitution. So I would go into juvenile detention facilities and talk to kids about a pimp and talk about this fictional engagement with, you know, revolution and justice. And in that work, I started to discover that there were very young girls who were being trafficked, very young girls who were in contact with the juvenile court, and that they were experiencing a level of trauma that was not being addressed. I kind of tucked it away because I didn't know what to do with it at the time. But when I intentionally set out to engage around Pushout, I found that a lot of the girls had read Too Beautiful for Words when I would walk in. So immediately when I walked in, they engaged with me differently because I had written a street novel. So they were like, oh, she can hang with us. Like, I can talk to her in a way that's different than how I might talk to another person who's coming in here as a researcher. So for me, that was a practice of allowing myself to bring my whole self to the inquiry, allowing myself not to shed the piece of me that they connected with most, but to engage the piece that they connect with most so that I could get information that might inform how we do this work moving forward. It was a different experience, and one that I said one day I may write about it because I think that as researchers and scholars in this work, sometimes we feel that we can't bring our whole selves to an inquiry, and in fact, many of our methods discourage us from doing that. But when we're, depending on the question we're asking, and if this is a true partnership, individuals on the receiving end of that can feel when you're holding something back and it feels exploitative. So that process meant that I had to basically be with girls, and I had to talk to them in ways that I would talk to my family. And I had to engage with them as human beings and engage them and their expertise as valuable. And that was particularly important to girls whose intellectual engagement has been undermined at every turn. So to tell a girl who's been called stupid, who's been told she's not worthy of being in the classroom, that what she has to share is going to be at the center of national discussions across the country, and that I'm going to use their narratives to help people understand what's going on, that was, for a lot of girls, just a brand new experience. And I included in some of the book when one of the girls said to me, wait, what are you gonna do with this again? And I said, you know, I had to go through my IRB protocol around, you know, I'm gonna write about this, I'm gonna talk about this, you know. And then she was, and I said, well, what do you want me to do? Because other people want me to write fictional pieces. Some people want me to write a book. And she told me, just tell the truth. You know, and the fact that she just said to me, I just want you to tell the truth, was to me a powerful statement about how they were approaching this work, what they saw as the value of this work, and what my responsibility was then as a researcher and writer in this space. But I do think, you know, the engagement with folks, I just see myself as much as I can in the people that I'm interacting with is my philosophy of life. I try to find myself in everyone and try to make a human connection in a way that just uplifts the humanity of all of us.
Love to, yeah.
Thank you for being a teacher. A lot of people saw Pushout as a critique of teachers, and that was unfortunate to me, because I believe in the promise of education, and I know the incredible power of educators, and the incredible responsibility of educators. There have been tremendous conversations that I've been able to have with folks across the country who are leading schools, but also leading classrooms, to try to facilitate a climate that can support the well-being of all students, instead of, you know, sort of constructing spaces where there's a structure of authority and safety that might be inconsistent with the way that some of the girls are interpreting their need. So I always encourage teachers to think about ways to co-construct safety in the classroom with their students, to think about developing a climate with students that allows for them to express themselves, to develop mutual agreements. A lot of times as educators, we might develop our class rules and we have them ready on day one and we invite the kids in and we go over our rules, right? But we don't engage in a conversation with the kids about what they need to feel safe, what safety looks like to them, which might be different than what our rules address. And so as a result, there's no real system of accountability around how we're going to learn together. I've found that the classrooms and the educators that do take the time to develop that at the outset are the most successful at creating a climate that is inclusive but also responsive to the needs of kids. There are lots of models that I've seen in terms of folks looking at developing a village structure in schools, where there are individuals who are accountable for certain things. Like in a village, we know we have a healer. We know we have a person who is going to hold space in different ways. Identifying students to take on those responsibilities also creates a sense of community that allows for kids to feel safe. I'm very grateful to the neuroscience community that has been looking at how the brain reacts to trauma, but also how we can engage culturally responsive teaching to make kids feel safe so that they can learn. We know if kids don't feel safe, they can't concentrate. Any one of us knows that if we're not feeling totally at ease, it's hard for us to focus. So building a climate in the classroom that facilitates conditions of safety with the students is a really important part of this work. Part of our development at the Institute is to engage in processes with schools to develop a structured decision-making tool to help teachers who may not be particularly trained or feel confident in making decisions across the board and responding to kids equally. And you know, not every kid needs the same intervention. Like, part of what we want to do is build capacity and understanding among educators that engaging with empathy is what every kid needs. Every kid needs to know you care. Every kid needs to know that you're there for them. And now that we know that, let's figure out how to respond to harm in a way that can facilitate that child's development and healing. In our pilot educational reentry program, which works with girls who are in contact, this is a very long answer to your question, but in our pilot educational reentry program that works with girls who have had a history of contact with the juvenile court, the vast majority of our girls have experienced some form of exploitation, mostly sexual exploitation, Majority of them have experienced school pushout. They are Black and Latina girls. We spend a lot of time, and our team spends a lot of time really thinking about how to cultivate healing in the classroom as a strategy to engage this question of safety. And so it's not that we want to implement safety, because I don't believe that that's possible. I don't believe that the presence of law enforcement or the threat of suspension makes a classroom safer. In fact, it does the opposite. But what we're trying to do in our program is to develop a structure of accountability that's shared, and to create space for girls to learn and to express themselves in their process of learning. So there might be random acts of dance. There might be random outbursts of joy. And that's okay. There also may be conflict, and that needs resolution. But that's how we treat it. We say there's conflict, let's resolve it, not get out. Our girls have been told get out too many times, so we're trying to think about ways to engage them. And we're learning a lot from them. So to your other question about what I learn, is that we learn that love is the greatest intervention tool. It is the greatest intervention tool. A lot of times that's hard for people to digest because it feels abstract, but the reality is when you engage people with love and human dignity, they respond. This punishment, this fear, this idea that you have to put little girls in handcuffs because they're having a tantrum, it's ridiculous, really. And so, you know, I think we have to move out of our framework of fear to understand that every kid is there because they are attempting to learn something. Now, if they are disruptive and they're not participating the way that we expect, it's usually because something else is going on. So building relationships and understanding how to get to a place where that person, that kid, has a safe person on campus also goes a very long way in facilitating safety and a very long way in increasing their respect for the adults that are working with them.
Another question from the audience?
I try to be responsive to emerging language and to shift accordingly. I also, when you engage in participatory work, if you're not ready, if you're not already there, the community you're working with will correct your language. which is hard sometimes for folks who have spent years framing their own language to accept. If you go into community and you have your language, but the community rejects your language and wants instead to use their language. And so there are other skills required in the development of language that do involve deep listening, that do involve operating with respect and coming to and setting agreements around this work. I do believe that there are many words and constructs that were built from the history and legacy of oppression in this country. And so to undo that requires us to interrogate language differently and in a way that we don't routinely do. And so, you know, a lot of what we say is problematic. A lot of what we do in response to what we have said is inconsistent with some of the emerging practices and theories around how we engage around certain topics. I always encourage, you know, the use or the exploration of language as a part of this work because it is so powerful. And it also informs our learning. So I found, for example, with Pushout, that a lot of people had talked about commercial sexual exploitation, but I found that when you talk to girls about their situation, they don't want to use that term, right? And adults have a framework and advocates have a framework around this, but if you responded or were trying to work with some of the girls, they would say, well, I'm not sexually exploited, right? And they would say, well, I'm not a prostitute. I don't do that, right? And they'd be very serious with their rejection of that term. But then when you talk to them further, they'll say, oh, but I bust dates. right? And so once you said, okay, well, what's busting a date then? You know, then that was the language they were familiar with, that was the language they were comfortable with, but it was a different frame than labeling them something. They rejected the label, not necessarily the activity. And so it informs our capacity, it increases our capacity, really, to connect and engage with girls as advocates, but also as scholars and as scholar advocates, right, who are trying to produce information and trying to connect with different folks with varying degrees of decision-making power to intervene and to work with them in ways that are respectful of their experience, but also their identities. And so I think the way you get good at doing that is to practice, keep going into communities, keep talking to different folks that you haven't spoken with before. It's very easy to go back into a routine around folks that you're used to engaging with. It's a lot harder to develop a skill of being able to negotiate various communities and talk with folks differently. It takes time, be patient. You will make mistakes, that's okay. And apologize if you make a mistake. You know, enter spaces humbly. That's kind of my rule. But I do appreciate your elevation of this question of language, because oftentimes we use it without consideration for how it might be impacting people, but it also is part of how we facilitate safe spaces and climate, and also, you know, the intention that we set forth in our interactions with each other. I mean a continual engagement of action around a particular issue. Practice, 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 engagement, merging theory with action. And so for me, you know, a lot of times, I labeled this talk social justice as a verb, knowing that social justice, if you are a linguist or an English major, it's probably frustrating you know, to great levels. But I really want to encourage us to think outside of social justice only as a way to capture a theory, or a way to think about our engagement around these issues of deep community and extensive community impact in terms of scholarship without action. We produce a lot of information, and we believe that it has value, especially if we write for each other. And I really want to make sure that I'm encouraging all of us who are interested in this work to consider all the ways in which the work that we produce can have great community impact if we engage in partnerships, if we merge that theory with action, and if we are intentional about building relationships with communities, coalitions, individuals that are seeking to really effectuate change. I think I've seen just too many papers sit on a shelf or be archived in a way that is useful for a particular career. And I said before, we have a deep problem with this, with merging you know, the what we know about a topic with what we do on that topic. And a lot of that is because we're not having conversations with each other in meaningful ways. And so if we're interested in social justice, we have to think about our inquiry as being something that can activate, not just live in a library. I love libraries, but we wanted to move beyond that.
I thought I might follow up with kind of a careerish question. You know, I think a lot of students today even coming from Williams, you know, are entering a job market that is scary, in a world that's sort of scary in many ways, and I think I love this concept of social justice as a verb and as a practice, but I'm wondering if you can reflect on your experience of how you've managed to pursue that in your life without kind of getting scared away, and what the resources you've drawn on as you've moved through a lot of different fields and in a lot of different spaces to be able to kind of continually refine that practice. Yeah, so what makes that possible for you, I guess? And what can these young people, as they're going out into the world, what can they think about doing that will make it possible for them?
I just believe that authenticity goes a long way. I try to be me wherever I am. And that has played out differently in different spaces. I realized very early on that corporate America was not for me. I would wear suits and be in spaces, but I always wore my hair natural, And people would come up to me and say, they let you wear your hair like that, right? Like there were things that told me that there were places where I could be fully me, and there were places where I could not be fully me. And I made the decision to create spaces and be in spaces where I could always be me. That has meant that what I like to say is my work has been consistent over decades. The places where I do that work, those have changed. Until I found that there was no place that could house the work that I was doing, so I had to create it. And that's something I want to share. You know, I shared that earlier, and I think it's important for folks who are coming out now to hear, because sometimes we think, I've got to enter the job market, I've got to get in this space, and you do. You know, I'm sure your parents are like, you need a job. And that's real, you have to eat. But the reality is too, that if you are miserable, you will not be your best self, and so your contributions will be limited. And so I have always tried to think about being in spaces where I could see my contributions thriving, where I could be fully me in that process, and it took a while. There was once a time where I would actually wear Prince t-shirts under suits and not show them, because I was like, I love Prince, I love his swagger, I'm gonna take that on and engage that way. Everybody has their little lucky thing that they do. And then I was like, why am I hiding my Prince shirts? I'm just gonna wear them. But there are little things that you do to show that you are fully who you are, and I realized that when I started showing that part of me, I was connecting with people differently, right? I was connecting with funders differently. Now they wanted to suddenly be in conversation with me. I was connecting with other partners in tech differently. Suddenly they wanted to connect with me on social media and talk prints, but they also wanted to talk about other ways that we might connect and do this work together. So, you know, I think it's really important to identify ways to be whole. It's something that we're trying to do in our work. Like we say these things in social justice spaces, and we say these things in our environments that we want to create spaces where people can be healthy and whole, but we don't practice it. I try to practice it. So it's really important to know that if you continue to search for a place where you feel whole, and if you don't find it, create it. You can do that.
Do we have one last question from somebody out there?
I think that's a beautiful space too. Thank you. but I do think that there is, like I said, you know, much of the interrogations that we get from music and things that we learn from our own presentational engagement with certain things that can help to inform how we think about this topic. A lot of folks talk about the Beatles that way. People talk about Stevie Wonder that way. You know, and so for me, it's Prince. And I think, you know, in certain ways, Jill Scott. But I think it's really a great way to explore this concept of space. The one thing I want to reiterate that I said in the talk is that social justice is not a pie. And we always talk about divvying up opportunity and distributing opportunity, but we really have to see this as an infinite space that has as much possibility as there are, you know, available. And so, when we think about engagement with people and exploring opportunities for justice in this way, that purple rain, that space of purple rain is extensive. It's very extensive. It's not limited.
I don't know how we could possibly end on a better note than that. So,
more time, and also Anika for the lovely introduction. For those that don't know me, I'm Shauna Patterson-Stevens. I'm in the Davis Center. And I just want to thank you again for joining us this evening. It's our hope that you acquired a newfound understanding on ways to operationalize your interest in creating socially just spaces. I would like to also thank the Davis Lecture Committee for all their insight and contributions toward this project. I'd like to thank the Oakley Center, the Lecture Committee, and the W. Ford Schumann Program in Democratic Studies for their gracious contributions to this event. It's our aim to continue to host these discussions in the future. We don't want it to stop here, and so we encourage you to also engage with us in the future throughout this academic year, next year for those that aren't graduating, and so on. Because we want to make sure that we're creating robust opportunities to engage the community, create community in a way that is inclusive, productive, and equitable. So thank you again for your time tonight. We really, really appreciate it, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.